Amen. All right, have a seat. As you obviously know, Gino's out, coming back. So have Bill Jack here. Bill, how long have we known you? Been quite a while, even through Team Pact and everything. A couple of months, yeah, okay. Bill, what I like about Bill is he goes, especially with a homeschooling conference, I don't know if he still does it, but back, I know you did before, worked with the youth track, and like what they do with Worldview Academy, took them out after some training during that time, and they would go to the park or the zoo or whatever and talk to people and teach these kids how to witness, how to talk to people. And I'm sure he'll talk about some of his videos that he has and other things. So we're blessed to have Bill. So without further ado, come up, Bill. Tell us a little bit about Worldview and your CDs.
Well, thank you for having me here. It's good to be back again, and it's always a joy to be up here. Thank you. This is going to be a little bit different because it's going to be more issues related than scripture related. It was interesting to hear your song choice because I recall my dad singing The Wonder of It All when I was a kid in church, and brought back memories. And my wife requested Peace Like a River. At her memorial. So I can't stay in the room when that's sung. But we are here, and they are there, because of the Creator. And that's what we're going to talk about this morning. It is because of the Creator. Please pick up a copy of my newsletter. It's on the back table there as you leave. And keep me in your prayers. I'd appreciate that. Keep Worldview Academy in your prayers. As you know, every organization is challenged and enticed to drift whenever they're organized on a solid foundation. There's always that push to drift. And so please keep us in your prayers that we do not drift from the solid foundation of God's Word. And we have not. On the back table, there's, I understand you've been studying Origins and Answers in Genesis series on that. I have a 9-week study guide that Worldview puts out. This one is on Origins. It doesn't deal with the science issue at all. It deals with what does Scripture say. And I think it might be beneficial in your study as well. There's also a DVD that goes with it. It's called The Emperor's New Clothes. Exposing the naked truth of evolution and progressive creationism. And we need to start saying the emperor has no clothes on in the culture because this is a foundational issue. How you answer the question of origins will determine everything else. And there's a buddy of mine who is an evangelist. He's probably one of the most powerful speakers, one of the top five speakers I've heard in my entire life, Greg Steer, just down the road in Arvada. Has a ministry called Dare to Share. You can check it out. Greg's used to roof houses for a living, and he told me one time. He said, "Bill, if the foundation of a house is cracked, the house is jacked." I said, "Greg, what do you mean by that?" He said, "Well, you can put the most expensive roof you want to on the building, but if that foundation is cracked, that roof will leak like a sieve. You first have to jack up the foundation before you put the roof on." And what is the foundation of everything that we as Christians believe? As you've been studying in Answers in Genesis curriculum, and as I often say, it is the first three chapters of Genesis. If I can create doubt in the historicity of the first three chapters, I can undermine every doctrine of the Christian faith. If the foundation's cracked, the house is jacked, okay? And we need to rebuild the foundations, okay? Scripture says if the foundations are destroyed, what can the righteous do? And we often quote that in despair, but the next verse talks about how God is sovereign, and we need to recognize that. So do not despair and do not give up in hope. Give up hope because, well, because of the Creator. And that's what we're going to be looking at. What I'm going to be talking about this morning is also on a DVD called the Thule-Jack Debate. And this is a debate that I did several years ago at a church down in North Glen or Thornton area with Dr. Michael Thule, who's a philosophy professor at the University of Colorado. And we debated the issue of origins. The debate was based on this resolution. Society is better off adopting an evolutionist model than a creationist model. Now, who has the benefit, who has the edge in this debate?
I do.
Why? Because the burden of proof is on him. Who in their right mind would agree to this topic from the other side? And yet he did. Why? Out of arrogance. I have a friend who sat under his instruction. Dr. Thule was a postdoc instructor. He taught those who were getting advanced degrees, and my friend was studying to get his doctorate in philosophy, and he said, Dr. Thule sets out to destroy Christians. He makes that very clear in his classes. And so he agreed to this debate. Now, you have to understand the implications of this resolution, and that is, better off implies that there are benefits, right? It's not a merely an advantage, but it's a kindly, charitable act. That's a value judgment. And that flows from one's worldview, does it not? A worldview is a set of lenses through which you view everything around you. It's your filter for understanding reality. Two big questions that any good worldview will attempt to answer. First question is, what's the nature of? Thank you. And the second one is, what's the nature of? Man. You answer those two questions, I will tell you your worldview. It's not because it's magic, it's just that biblical Christianity answers those two questions radically differently than any other worldview out there. We stand unique. We're not just another choice on the spectrum. We're not just another choice on the smorgasbord of ideas and worldviews. We stand radically apart from every other worldview out there because of those two questions and how we answer them. And so it has implications. And it starts with the foundation. Starts with the foundation. We're not going to be looking at a lot of scripture, but I want you to turn to Colossians 2:8. Half of you turn there. And then the other half turn to 2 Corinthians 10:5. Or you can do two fingers if you want. But whoever finds Colossians 2:8, read that loudly for me, please. Again, we're doing a Bible drill. Jen. See to it that no one takes you captive through philosophy or empty deception, according to the traditions of men, according to the elementary principles of the world, rather than according to Christ. I want you to keep that open, okay? And somebody find, we're not to be taken captive, okay? And yet we are surrounded by secularism. It is the water in which we fish swim, is it not? We can't help but breathe that air. But we are not to be taken captive, but the other hand, we are to do something. Okay? And that's found in 2 Corinthians 10:5. Who's got 2 Corinthians 10:5? Second Corinthians 10:5? You're doing it again, I think. Okay, read that again for me.
Casting down imagination and every high thing that exalted itself above the knowledge of Christ.
We are to take every thought captive, and we're to destroy, demolish.
Bringing into captivity.
Yes, and we're to destroy sloppy ideas, bad thinking. Okay, vain imaginations. I think that the King James says, we're to destroy vain imaginations, and we're to take every thought captive. So we are not to be taken captive, and then we are to take every thought captive. And it starts with the foundation. Starts with the foundation. So, why are we here? Because that's the real question, right? That's the question of origins. Why are we here? Composer John Cage said, no why, just here. Actor Leonard Nimoy, Dr. Spock, said, I find the question, why are we here, typically human. I'd suggest, are we here, would be the more logical choice. Okay. Or, late paleontologist Stephen Jay Gould, leading spokesman for evolution until his death. I have it on good authority that he's no longer an evolutionist. He's dead. But even in the state in which he finds himself, he's still probably shaking his fist in the face of his creator. That should give us pause, should it not? He said this, we are here because one odd group of fishes had a peculiar fin anatomy that could transform into legs for terrestrial creatures. We may yearn for a higher answer, but none exists. Pretty despairing, right? The question of origins is a foundational question. How you answer the question of origins will determine how you make your money, how you spend your money, how you view your parents, how they view you, how you view those who are about to enter this life and those who are about to leave this life. Or as the old Beatles song goes, my parents told me about the Beatles. Will you still need me? Will you still feed me when I'm... Oh, there are some other refugees from the 60s here. How you answer the question of origins will determine what you do with the person of Jesus Christ. He is who he claimed to be, the creator of everything, or he is, as one man so aptly put it, nothing more than a liar or a lunatic. This is a foundational issue, and if the foundation is cracked, the house is jacked. We've got to decide whom we're going to trust on this issue before we start looking at the evidence. This has nothing to do with evidence. It has to do with the social impact of evolution. Again, don't take my word for it, but listen to a man by the name of Richard Bosworth, who wrote an article entitled The Meaning of Evolution, and he published it in the American Atheist magazine, which kind of tells you where he's coming from. He said, Christianity has fought, still fights, and will fight science to the desperate end over evolution because evolution destroys utterly and finally the very reason that Jesus' earthly life was supposedly made necessary. Destroy Adam and Eve and the original sin, and in the rubble you will find the sorry remains of the Son of God. Take away the meaning of his death. If Jesus was not the Redeemer who died for our sin, and that's what evolution means, then Christianity is nothing. Do you understand what this man said? If evolution is true, then the Bible is. But if the Bible is true, then evolution is bogus. Everybody say it with me, bogus. It's either creation, or it's evolution, or it's creation, or it's evolution. You can't mix these two together. And yet, I find that's where most Christians are. They think it's a secondary issue. And if you, we do a bridge year program down in Canyon City for students who are just out of high school who want to get grounded and rooted in their faith before they hit college or their career path. Two-semester program. They can receive 27 hours of transferable credit through Corbin University out of Oregon. So it's basically their humanities of their freshman year. And we deal with this issue extensively. But I just sent my students from my worldview class back to their churches. They have to attend a local church. And I said, ask three people in your church where you're attending this year what they view as foundational. If they view origins, if they view Genesis 1, 2, and 3 literally or metaphorically. It's amazing. I said, one of the people you have to interview is a pastor. You know. People in the pews say, yeah, I take it literally. You know what the pastor says? No. He said, it's too divisive. Yeah, the gospel's divisive, okay? But most churches will not take a position on this issue. It is foundational. And if the foundation is cracked, the house is, we got to decide whom we're going to trust. But don't take my word. Atheist Frank Zindler said this: the most devastating thing, though, that biology did to Christianity was the discovery of biological evolution. Now that we know that Adam and Eve never were real people. By the way, what's your question for him? How do we know that? Okay. How do we know that? Okay. Oops, lost him. Technology went away. It's amazing. How did Paul ever preach the gospel? Without technology. How does he know that the central myth of Christianity has been destroyed? Okay. And we need to lay hands on it, right? It's showing up on my screen, so it should show up on yours. There we go. I think maybe it's going to come back here in a minute. No, I'm in your camp now. Yeah. There we go. There we go. Thank you. Now that we know that Adam and Eve never were real people, the central myth of Christianity is destroyed. If there never was an Adam and Eve, there never was an original sin. If there never was an original sin, there's no need of salvation. If there's no need of salvation, there's no need of a Savior. And I submit that puts Jesus, historical or otherwise, into the ranks of the unemployed. I think that evolution is absolutely the death knell of Christianity. Unfortunately, atheists and evolutionists have figured out this issue better than most Christians have. Do you understand what he said? If Adam and Eve were never real people, then there's no original sin. If there's no original sin, there's no need of salvation. If there's no need of salvation, there's no need of a Savior. And that makes the work of Christ on the cross a mockery. And it's only Christians who are willing to compromise on this. We kind of get squishy on this, and we shouldn't. Which is more valuable in our culture? The unborn eagle or the unborn child? In our culture, it's the eagle. You can receive a $5,000 fine and a federal jail term for merely disturbing the nest in which there is an egg of an unborn eagle. And yet there are so-called physicians who receive thousands upon thousands of dollars for purposely taking the lives of unborn children. Now, why is that? It's because we have accepted the religion of evolution. It says the unborn child and the unborn eagle are both equal in value because they're both a product of the same system of chance. One may be more highly evolved in one area than another, but they're both equal in value because they're both a product of chance. Here's the question then. Why then is the eagle protected and the child not protected? Because there are fewer eagles than there are unborn children. So suddenly the unborn eagle becomes more equal than the unborn child. Now the logic is skewed unless you start with their underlying worldview, and then it makes perfect sense. This is a foundational issue. Here was Dr. Michael Tooley's position, and he outlined this in articles and books that he wrote in the 1980s. Now hold that date in mind. Since I do not believe human infants are persons, but only potential persons, and since I think that the destruction of potential persons is a morally neutral act, the correct conclusion seems to be to me to be that infanticide is itself morally acceptable. Now notice he didn't say abortion. What did he say? Infanticide. He wrote this in the 1980s. And he is instructing those who go on to be PhDs in philosophy. Now, you and I don't know too many philosophers, but they have an impact on what we think and how we act because they advise advertisers. They advise corporations. Ideas have consequences. Good ideas, excellent consequences. Bad ideas, victims. We're seeing the victims in Israel now because of bad ideas, are we not? Worldviews matter. He also wrote this: In conclusion, then, it is far from clear that the commonly accepted distinction between active and passive euthanasia is morally significant. I have tried to argue in some detail that the distinction between killing and letting die is not morally significant in itself. I tell my students at Worldview, I tell my students at the Abbey program, the Bridgier program, that we all have survived the Holocaust of abortion. We all have survived the Holocaust of infanticide. And I will probably survive the Holocaust of euthanasia. By the way, that's not the opposite of young people in Europe. It's a dad joke. Euthanasia, young people in Europe. I've survived. I will have survived euthanasia. But if it continues to go as it seems to be going, that my students, they will not. Their grandchildren will put them down. Ideas have consequences. Good ideas, excellent consequences. Bad ideas, victims. If evolution is true, not only have you thrown away the ability to know anything for certain, but there is no meaning or significance, no law, only exploitation, no purpose, only survival, no basis for morals or ethics. There's no love, only hormones. We talked about love in the Sunday school hour. How many of you have been told at some point in your life that you're nothing but a bundle of hormones? Anybody been told that? Now, we kind of make a joke out of that, okay? But it's really one of the greatest insults you could ever be paid. When they say that you're nothing but a bundle of hormones, they assume you act as what? An animal. Now, when an animal decides to mate, does it do so discriminately or indiscriminately? Indiscriminately. When an animal decides to eat your face, does it sit down and ponder the moral implication of having such a meal? No, it just what? Chows down. Okay. So when they say that you're nothing but a bundle of hormones, that really is undermining every basis, the foundation of what we believe. I said if the foundation is cracked, the house is jacked. Let me reillustrate that. What's the fruit of the Spirit? And self-control. When they say that you're nothing but a bundle of hormones, they assume you act as an animal. Now, again, can an animal exhibit self-control? And some are going, well, you know, Bill, I have a little dog. His name is Fluffy. And I put a biscuit on Fluffy's nose, and I back up, and I say, Fluffy, don't you eat that? And I back up, and I say, Fluffy, don't you eat that? And then I say, Fluffy, eat it. And he goes, rah, rah, rah. Is Fluffy exhibiting self-control? No, what have you done? You've trained Fluffy. I guarantee you, if I put you and Fluffy in a boxcar and lock it up for a week, only one is going to be coming out, and it's not going to be you. You see, evolution undermines every doctrine of the Christian faith. Beyond that, chance and chaos are the ultimate realities. Can anyone, creationist or evolutionist, exist on that? They can't be consistent. This is a foundational issue. We don't have time for that. So we're going to be looking at creation versus evolution. So let's define some terms here. Creation. Matter and life were brought into the being by the living eternal creator. The existence of every system in the material universe is the result of an intelligent design. And everything in the universe has a purpose and a function. And this creator is the God of the Bible. Now, this last point is very important because there are organizations out there who say, we're just going to deal with the science. Just give me the facts. What's the problem with that? Every fact has to be interpreted in light of one's worldview. Okay, just because I have a white lab coat and a pocket protector doesn't make me objective, right? So, any problem with this as a definition, a working definition? We need to define evolution. Evolution says that all the material universe is a result of chance arrangements of atoms responding to known physical and chemical laws, that life arose from non-living matter, and the diversity of living systems is a result of random mutations acted upon by natural selection and chance. Oops, sorry, back. Somebody wants to take a picture of that. Okay. Any problem with this is a working definition. So we are on the same page as far as terms go. So let's take a look at, is there any evidence for evolution? Colin Patterson, who was the leading paleontologist at the British Museum of Nature and Science, woke up one morning and he said, I realized I'd been working on this stuff for over 20 years and there was not one thing I knew about it to be true. So he began to ask this question at various seminars where he spoke. In fact, at the University of Chicago, at the Evolutionary Morphology Seminar, a very prestigious body of evolutionists, he asked this question: can you tell me anything that you know about evolution, any one thing that is true? He said, for the longest time, there was silence. And finally, one person stood up and he said, I do know one thing, evolution ought not be taught in high schools. Now, these are evolutionists who understand the impact of evolution. It's not science. At best, it is a philosophy of science. Now notice, I said it was a model. I prefer the term model. Creation is a model. What is a model? What is a model? Something that represents reality. So it's an attempt to explain reality. You may have collected model trains when you were young, or you may still have a collection of model trains, or model cars. Or a model is somebody who represents something else, or reality, right? Well, in most cases, non-reality. Never mind, we're not going to go there. So a model is a representation, an attempt to explain reality. Now, why do I say it's not a theory? Because theories can eventually be proven or disproven. Now, it's a model because it's beyond the scope of science. It's not even good philosophy of science. How do you do science? Okay, you guys are looking a little bored with me. Okay, we're going to do a science experiment, okay? Okay, grab the bottom of your chairs. You have to do this because it's so exciting it may blow you out of your seat. Okay? Okay, here we go. You ready for this? Wow! Wasn't that exciting for one Sunday morning? What did I just test? Gravity. Can we repeat that? Can you stand this much excitement on one Sunday morning? Yes. Can I measure that? Can I study it? Can I observe it? That's how you do science. So if creation were science, was there any human observer? No. Can we repeat it? How many times did life come from a creator? Once. Can't we repeat it? No. Can we test it? Can we observe? No. You can't. So it's not science. It's beyond the scope of science. What about evolution? If evolution happened, how many times did life come from non-living matter? Once. Were there any human observers? No. Can we repeat it? No. Can you study it? Can you measure it? No. Can't test it. Both are beyond the scope of science, so they're models. And these models have implications. They have implications in science, law and ethics, human relations and public charity, and epistemology. Epistemology is a study of how you know anything, okay? The study of knowledge. So let's take a look at science. And again, somebody read for me Colossians 2:8 loudly. Colossians 2:8 says what? And no, we're not going back to the back row. Sorry. And he's sitting too close to my computer, so that's the problem right there. Yeah. Yes, please.
See to it that no one takes you captive by philosophy and empty deceit according to human tradition, according to the elemental spirits of the world, and not according to God.
See to it that no one takes you captive. Science. Is often, the issue of origins is often put as faith versus facts. It's often described as non-science versus true science, religion versus reality. It is none of those. These are two models, two competing models, and they have implications in science. Is evolution fact or theory? Eugenie Scott, executive director of the National Center for Science Education, said evolution is a theory. It's much more important than a fact because theories explain things. As I said earlier, Stephen Jay Gould said every fact must be interpreted in light of theory. It's your set of glasses through which you filter the world around you. Science truly is the daughter of creation, as Alfred North Whitehead has said. All of the great advances in science have been made by men and women who, first of all, recognized a creator and then went out into the world to discover the order that he put into the world. Just for example, let's take one guy. Let's just take Joseph Lister, for which we have Listerine, is named after Joseph Lister. Do you realize that Joseph Lister had this radical idea that in hospitals, birthing place. What do they call birthing, where babies are born? Thank you. Okay, thanks. In maternity wards, he had this radical idea that doctors should wash their hands between patients. He was almost driven out of medicine because they mocked him so soundly. The mortality rate in maternity wards was extremely high. He said, just wash your hands between patients and it'll stop it. They wouldn't listen to him. Now, where did you get that idea? From Scripture. Christians made great advances. Louis Pasteur nullified the idea of spontaneous generation, that life comes from non-life. It's the law of biogenesis. Okay? Law of biogenesis is life only comes from life. Law of non-biogenesis, life does not come from non-life. And yet, what is the foundational principle of evolution? Life comes from non-life, by chance. Scientists are in denial. Richard Dawkins, Oxford scientist, leading atheist, said this: it is absolutely safe to say that if you meet somebody who claims not to believe in evolution, that person is ignorant, stupid, or insane, or wicked, but I'd rather not consider that. By the way, if there is no God, what is? How can you be wicked? If there is no God, then whatever is, is. No, if there is no God, then whatever is right. You can't tell me that one side or t'other over in the Middle East is right or wrong. You cannot judge individual actions as being right or wrong. It just is. But we're going to get to that. Creation benefits everyone. We must learn to bear the truth about creation, no matter how pleasant it may be, in the area of science. So when it comes to this, it is why? Because of the Creator. Those are four words that should trip off the Christian's tongue whenever asked why we do anything. It's because of the Creator. Why do you do your job and do it excellently? Because of the Creator. Why do you love your children? Because of the Creator. Why do you obey speed limit? Well, we won't talk about that. Why do you come to church? Because of the Creator. Why do you give charitably? Because of the Creator. You see why that should trip off the tip of our mind every time we're asked why we do anything? It's because of the Creator. So how about law and ethics? If you hold to an evolutionary model, the individual's worth is extrinsic. The individual only has worth if he can contribute to society. Otherwise, you just become a useless eater. The strong survive and the powerful rule. Arbitrary laws are created by elite rulers. Have we not seen that? Sounds like Washington. Private property, your mind, your body, and the fruit of one's labor are tenuous or non-existent at best. What's the greatest piece of property you own? It is your mind. And what you pour into a person's mind will determine how he thinks, and how he thinks will determine how he acts. That's why education by nature is religious. I taught for 10 years. How I dressed conveyed values to my students. How I addressed my students conveyed values. Education by nature is religious. And yet we've made it a neutral ground, have we not? It is not neutral. Private property is tenuous or non-existent at best. Personhood is defined by arbitrary rules, as are the laws that govern their actions. Have we not seen that in the past 50 years with the unborn? Those are the outworkings of an evolutionary view. In fact, here's the biggest thing. The group takes precedence over the individual. When it comes to laws and ethics, this is what evolution means. But don't take my word for it. Hitler said the individual is nothing, the group, the Nazi Party, is everything. When group rights get the upper hand, gone are the unalienable rights given to us by the Creator. However, if you hold to a creationist view, individual worth flows from the Creator. Laws are absolute and are revealed by the Creator. Man does not create laws, man discovers laws. I'm trying to remember the representative's name. Her last name is Garcia, if I'm not mistaken. She was conducting a committee hearing last session at the State House. And there was a man testifying about a particular issue, and he said, these are God-given rights. She interrupted him and said, God does not give rights, we do. She needs to be driven out of office. Even society's weakest receive protection. Property rights result in a free market. Personhood is defined by the Creator, as are the laws that govern mankind. And finally, the individual matters. Jesus did not come to die for the group. He came to die for you, and me, and you. Not for the group. You see the difference there? You have value and worth because the Creator died for you. That makes you worthy. You weren't worthy for him to die for you. He gave you worth because of that. So, why do we have laws and ethics? Oh, that was pretty weak. Because of the Creator. When it comes to human relations and public charity, the evolutionist position. And again, somebody read for me, Colossians 2:8. Read it loudly.
See to it that no one takes you captive by philosophy and empty deceit, according to human tradition, according to the elemental spirits of the world, and not according to Christ.
Don't be taken captive. Here's the evolutionist position. Who said this? He who does not wish to fight in this world where permanent struggle is the law of life has not the right to exist. I do not see why man should not be just as cruel as nature. Any idea? Be bold, be strong. The Lord thy God is with thee. It happened to be Adolf Hitler. Evolutionist Sir Arthur Keith said this. The German Fuhrer, as I have consistently maintained, is an evolutionist. He has consciously sought to make the practice of Germany conform to the theory of evolution. Don't be taken captive. Ideas do have consequences. This scene from Schindler's List illustrates that very clearly.
No difference to us, you understand? This one, that one. It's the inconvenience to the list. It's the paperwork.
I somehow left my one card at home. I tried to explain that it was a mistake. Sorry, I'm stupid.
What if I got here 5 minutes later? Then where would I be?
My father was a World War II artillery spotter pilot. And like most World War II vets, he didn't talk much about his experience. But he did write about it, and in one letter he wrote the following. Near the close of the war, the 9th Armored Division had pulled back from Leipzig, Germany for rest. We were then to plunge into Czechoslovakia. Another pilot and I flew to nearby Weimar, where the infamous Buchenwald concentration camp had just been liberated. Buchenwald was especially notorious because of the camp commandant's wife. It wasn't just a prisoner of war camp, it was a death camp, but it was especially notorious because of the commandant's wife. She earned a nickname, which I can't say in polite company. But it was reported that anyone who showed up with an interesting tattoo immediately disappeared. And then it was discovered after the war that she furnished her office in a very gruesome way. She had human skulls for ashtrays, lampshades made out of human skins. He went on, we felt compelled to see if what we had heard was true. It was, and worse. After a horrifying inspection of 2 hours, I stood at the furnaces where emaciated, naked, mutilated bodies still were piled on the furnace carts. The stench of burned flesh and bodies still choked the air about the now stilled gas furnaces. I climbed a short ladder to stand on the earth-covered roof above the torture room that housed the body-stripping tables. At Buchenwald, prisoners were processed on one level and then thrown down a wooden chute where they landed on a table, and other prisoners would then beat out their teeth to retrieve any gold fillings while these prisoners were still alive. So what you just saw was not fantasy. It wasn't Hollywood. It was reality. He went on to write, the earth beneath my feet felt strangely loose and spongy. I stooped to scoop up a handful of the oddly blackened earth. My mind was clogged with the incomprehensible inhumanity demand that I had evidenced. It was then that I saw that the spongy dirt I absently let trickle from my palm through my fingers was not dirt at all. It was human ashes, small fragments of crushed, charred bone. In horror, I held for one moment in the palm of my trembling hand a helpless Jewish baby, a frantic young mother, a bewildered Jewish boy, a tottering grandmother. They drifted from my hand to rejoin the host of unknown, unremembered, nameless human beings who died in these furnaces before and with them. Ideas have consequences. Good ideas, excellent consequences. Bad ideas, victims. I know we all think, if only I'd been there, I would have. But no, we wouldn't have, because by the time those trains were running, it was too late. You see, ideas had captured the culture, and it was based on the idea of evolution. People will tell you, get on board with my worldview. One's worldview is much like a train. We climb on board as a child, not thinking about where the train is headed. We just tend to go along for the ride, do we not? That's what one's worldview is, and ideas do have consequences. The evolutionist position, who said this, Darwin's book is very important and serves me as a basis in natural science for the class struggle in history. Karl Marx. This is not a science issue. It's a worldview issue. Never has been a science issue. Never will be a science issue. It's beyond science. It is a worldview issue. Margaret Sanger, founder of Planned Parenthood. More children from the fit, less from children from the unfit, that is the chief issue of birth control. You think that's in their literature that they pass out at high schools these days? In the so-called clinics that they house right across the street from minority high schools? She wrote this, apply a stern and rigid policy of sterilization and segregation to that grade of population whose progeny is tainted or whose inheritance is such that objectionable traits may be transmitted to offspring. What does that smack of? Racism. These two words, birth control, sum up our whole philosophy. It means the release and cultivation of the better elements in our society and the gradual suppression, elimination, and eventual extinction of defective stocks, those human weeds which threaten the blooming of the finest flowers of American civilization. Is that in their literature? You know that she has a statue in the United States Capitol? Because every state can put up two heroes. In Arizona, I think, put up Margaret Sanger. In a letter to Dr. Clarence Gamble, she wrote this: "We don't want the word to get out that we want to exterminate the Negro population." And yet, who are targeted by Planned Parenthood more than anybody else? Minorities. Why? Because of this. Ideas have consequences. Bad ideas, victims. Francis Collins, retired NIH director, self-proclaimed Christian, when asked about abortion, said this: "Suppose it was possible in a rare instance for something that's about to be discarded with full consent after the decision by the mother to be used to develop something that might save somebody's life. In that case, I think even God could look at that and go, okay, it's not the thing I would have wanted to see happen. Still, as an ethical choice between discarding or using for some benevolent purpose, maybe that's defensible." Now, that will make some people uneasy. In other words, he's talking about using aborted babies for fetal research. That's reprehensible. And yet this man claims to be a Christian. Now why? He may love Jesus here, but he's trained to think over there, as are we all. We're just a few steps away from him because we're submersed in a secular worldview, and it starts with the issue of origins. Origin of the Species by Darwin, the subtitle of which is For the Preservation of the Favored Races. Is that taught in public schools? No, no. Francis Galton, who was a relative of Charles Darwin, this guy right here, is the founder of eugenics that Margaret Sanger advocated. Eugenics is the idea that there are certain people that are subhuman. The idea of races. We should not use the word race. How many races are there? One. It's called what? Human. The idea of races flows from an evolutionary construct that there are certain people groups that are not as evolved as others. The National Human Genome Research even admitted this, that this was a bad idea. Eugenics is the scientifically erroneous and immoral theory of racial improvement and planned breeding, which gained popularity during the 20th century. Notice they claim it's immoral. They claim it's immoral. They recognize, however, that it was used by Hitler and by others to define certain people out of the human race. Eugenics theories and scientific racism drew support from contemporary xenophobia, anti-Semitism, sexism, colonialism, and imperialism, as well as justifications of slavery, particularly in the U.S. They condemn it, and yet they hold tightly to the doctrine of Darwin, Darwinian. Hatred of a certain people group. Evolutionists may not be racist. I'm not claiming that. But evolution by nature is racist. You understand that? Mass murderer Jeffrey Dahmer. In an interview shortly before he was killed by a fellow prisoner, said, if a person doesn't think there is a God to be accountable to, then what's the point of trying to modify your behavior to keep it within acceptable ranges? That's how I thought anyway. I always believed the theory of evolution is truth, that we all just came from the slime. When we died, you know, that was it. There was nothing. By the way, Jeffrey Dahmer was led to Christ shortly before he was murdered in prison by a committed pastor who set out for that purpose. Our God is a very gracious God. I will shake hands with a cannibal someday in heaven. Well, he may not want to shake hands with me. when it comes to this idea of human relations and public charity. Somebody read 2 Corinthians 10:5 for me. Whoever's got it. Just to remind us. We are to take every thought captive to the obedience of Jesus Christ. We are to think God's thoughts after Him. Acts 17:26. And He made from one nation, one man, every nation of mankind to live on all the face of the earth. Why do we do what we do? It's because of the Creator. Hospitals and charitable organizations were founded to honor the Creator's work. Education for all, even poor and women, in order to train the creation's handiwork. Slavery was abolished by creationists. Christian charity and decency is a result of creationist mindset. All of these organizations were founded by Christians. They've been taken over by atheists, but they've been founded by Christians because of what? Because of? I can't hear you. Because of the Creator. Because of the Creator. We're not to be taken captive. We all have been by evolution, but we are to take every thought captive. When it comes to epistemology, how do you know? If you start with an evolutionary perspective, since everything happens by chance, the individual too is a product of chance, as is his brain. Therefore, you cannot tell me that what you're thinking is true and accurate if everything is random. Right and wrong, without a way of knowing truth, no action or idea can be deemed right or wrong. Again, if there is no God, whatever is right. Now, evolutionists, I'm not saying evolutionists are immoral. Evolutionists may have morality, but evolution has none and can offer none. All evolutionists can do is steal lumber from my worldview. Friedrich Nietzsche said this: when one gives up Christian belief, one thereby deprives oneself of the right to Christian morality. Christianity presupposes that man does not know, cannot know what is good for him and what is evil. He believes in God, who alone knows. Those who are evolutionists, who are atheists, are inconsistent. They steal lumber from our worldview. They can't have morality. And we need to call them on that. You cannot tell me what is evil because you have no standard. Because they will charge us by saying, oh, well, in the Bible, God ordered, you know, the entire nations be wiped out. That's evil. You can't even tell me what's evil unless you steal lumber from my worldview. See how that works? Why do we know what is right and wrong?
Because of the Creator.
So which model most benefits society? Evolution loves death. It celebrates death. It thrives on death. Something old has to die out before something new can take its place. Evolution is selfish. Over the past 80 plus years, and this is a conservative estimate, 190 million people have been purposely sacrificed on the altar of evolution and convenience in the world. We hear the argument, well, because of religious wars, millions have died. In the name of Christ, and yes, in the name of Christ, but not because of what Christ taught. It was in the name of religion, okay? Religion is very ugly, right? But if you want to add it up, if you want to play a numbers game, and I think it's absurd, but if you want to play a numbers game, given just the most liberal numbers, by those who have died in religious wars in the name of Christ, not because of what Christ taught, but in the name of Christ, it's like 17 million. There's no comparison between these two numbers. And yet we fall prey to that accusation. Creation celebrates life. Creation encourages followers to be selfless, to die to ourselves. Hospitals, charities, churches, schools, millions have been benefited as a result of a creationist worldview, a creationist mindset. We need to understand it is one reason that we do what we do. And it's four words. What is it? Because of the Creator. Number one, see to it that no one takes you captive through philosophy or empty deception, according to the traditions of men, according to the elementary principles of the world, rather than according to Christ. And number two, we are destroying arguments, speculations raised up against the knowledge of God, and we are taking every thought captive to the obedience of Christ. See to it. I realize I've raised more questions than I've answered. If you are interested in any of those materials out on the table over there, they're normally $20, and this was normally $13, but everything's $10. If you're interested in the debate, that's available. And then these two kind of go together, the 9-week study guide and the Emperor's New Clothes. You guys have been very patient and very gracious, as always. And I've been long-winded, as always. So it's time we close. Let me pray. Father, thank you for the hospitality and the grace that I always take in when I come here. Thank you for this group of believers who hold fast to your word, who stand firmly on the foundation of Genesis, knowing the implications that if the foundation is cracked, the house is jacked. May we go out and proclaim that truth, that your word is true everywhere, from beginning to end, in our daily conversations, in our confrontations with those who are hostile, and may we proclaim truth and grace. Thank you always for the truth of your word and for your Son Jesus, who is our Creator and our Redeemer. If he were not the Creator, then he could not be the Redeemer. And yet we honor him as both. It is because of the Creator that we have life and breath. May we use that life and breath to proclaim eternal life to those around us. We ask these things for Jesus. We ask that we look vertically before we look horizontally. We ask this in his name. Amen.